gather on this first Sunday in November, and we begin with the acknowledgement of land. For thousands of years, the people of the First Nations have lived on and tended these lands. We acknowledge that we are on the unceded territory of the Maliseet and the Mi'kmaq people, and for that, we are grateful. Welcome to this first Sunday in November, this Remembrance Sunday. We have some special people with us this morning. First of all, we have the Reverend Les Johnson, who is here on behalf of the wider church to conduct and share with you in the congregational meeting that will follow the service. So I'll be leaving you in his hands at the end of the service. Also, we have this morning, and taking part, members of the Scouting Movement as part of our act of remembrance. There are a few announcements. You have the announcement sheet, and please look that over and pay attention.
Can I make an announcement?
Oh, certainly.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I heard that somebody here had a very special birthday yesterday.
I wouldn't know who that is.
Reverend Brian celebrated his birthday yesterday. I don't want to say how old you are.
No. Well, I will.
You will? Okay. So I thought we would sing happy birthday, if that's all right. All right.
Sister of Earl Gordon. A visitation tonight and tomorrow night at the York Funeral Home, and the funeral will be taking place at the funeral home on Tuesday morning. So we do offer our sympathy to that family. And I will be expressing that on behalf of this church when we gather. Also want to mention that I started doing some visiting this past week. Welcomed into a number of homes. This week, because of the funeral and because of Remembrance Day, I won't be doing a whole lot of days visiting, but I will be around on Wednesday and Friday. And if you know of someone who would like a visit, or if you would like a visit, please let me know or let Judy know in the office. We're in regular communication. Other than that, please check those announcements that you have on your announcement sheet, and please take advantage of those opportunities to gather or to serve. God said, "Let there be light," and there was light, and God saw that it was good. This light is a symbol of God's continuing creative work. This light will remind us that that work, that creative work, is now in us and through us as well. We are part of God's work. Our call to worship. We gather to lift our devotion to God of all creation. May we be loyal to this nation, grateful to our country's heroes. May the ever faithful God receive our true worship this day. Let us pray. We gather this morning to worship our God, to pray for peace, and to remember the ways in which times of war have destroyed God's creation, the land, the water, the people.
We gather as the people of God.
We come together with all kinds of feelings, sadness, regret, repentance, pride, hope, gratitude, and thanksgiving.
We come as the people of God.
In all that we have been, in all that we are, in all that we hope to be, we come in song, in scripture, in poetry, and in prayer to worship you, our God. Amen. And our hymn, God, make us servants of your peace. He shall judge between the nations and shall rebuke many people. They shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. These are our thoughts for Remembrance Sunday. And now will you join with me as we pray together our prayer of confession. We confess to you, O God, as part of the world community, our inability to keep the peace that so many sacrificed to win and preserve, our inability to care for those in poverty and to seek justice for the marginalized, our lack of attention for issues that do not touch us personally, our inability to live out what we believe because it seems too hard. Forgive us, restore us, enable us to begin again to live the journey of faith. Amen. The confession of our sin before God and one another reminds us as individual believers and as a community of faith that we do not turn away from the ways of peace and peacemaking. We believe that if we do confess, we shall be forgiven and be freed from the burden of guilt and empowered to carry on the work of those who sought and fought for freedom. Amen. We move now into our act of remembrance and begin with the singing of O Canada.
Nashwaaksis United Church Honor Roll. Hugh Clarence Alexander. Lloyd Franklin Bailey. Edith Patricia Braun. Barry Allen Willis. Donald Lloyd Welch. Jean Pauline Johnson. Gerald C. T. Villers. Elmer Frederick Cladfield. David Crockett. Lloyd Arnold Curry. Robert Waldo Evans. Lawrence Gordon Fleming. Howard Hamilton. John Edward Harding. Herbert Reginald Harding. Cecil Albert Harding. Clifford Hazen Hawkins. Gertrude Evelyn Johnson. John Hamilton Johnson. Archibald McFarlane, Donald Stuart Murphy, Harold Charles Pond, Albert Alexander Smith, Edward Franklin Smith, Lloyd Allison Villars, S. Stuart Donald Wilcox, Charles Murray Willis, William Dawson Todd, Harold Percival Villars, and Robert Ellsworth Villars.
William George Burge, Richard Burge, Shelton Houston, James Schlosser, Private Claude Derrick, Norman W. Sobey, Oscar Vincent Higgins, Vincent Keith Higgins, active, Vincent Bartlett, Jason Rush, active, Miles and Wesley Brooks, J. Chester McCray, C. Curtis McCann, Colin Graham, David Girdwood Gerard, George Lloyd McFarlane, Corporal James Gavin Hardy, Lawrence Lewin, Jim Davis, W.L. Larry Ford, Morris MacArthur, Robert MacArthur, Wilson Crawford, Peter Thompson, active, Ross E. Gordon, Elaine Bailey Everett, Carl Everett, Arlene Bailey Meredith, George Meredith, Sergeant Major Charles W. Bolton, Sr., Major Alan C. Dwyer, active, Sergeant Jonathan Fullerton, CB, retired, Charles Curtis McCann, Clarence Forbes, Robert Burton, Ivan Calhoun, Leo Zink,
Gerard Byrne, Gerald Fullerton, John Gordon McDonald, Morris Morton Sr., Morris Morton Jr., William Morton, James Morton, Private Spencer McDonald, Private Hazen Calhoun, Fred Bartlett, Stanley Bartlett, Ralph Brandt.
Scouting movement to come and lay the wreaths. Let us pray. Eternal rest grant unto them, O God, and may perpetual light shine upon them.
May the souls of the righteous, through our great mercy, rest in peace. Amen.
Please be seated. We're going to sing a hymn, O for a World, verses 1, 2, and 5. He then would have had to suffer often since the foundation of the world, but now once at the end of the ages. He has appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. And so it is appointed for men to die once, but after this the judgment. So Christ offered once to bear the sins of many. To those who eagerly wait for him, he will appear a second time, apart from sin, for salvation. And our second reading is from the 12th chapter of the Gospel of Mark, 38 through 44. He said to them in his teaching, "Beware of the scribes, who desire to go around in long robes, love greetings in the marketplace, the best seats in the synagogues, and the best places at feasts, who devour widows' houses and for a pretense make long prayers. These will receive greater condemnation." Now Jesus sat opposite the treasury and saw how many people put money into the treasury, and many who were rich put in much. Then one poor widow came and threw in two mites. This poor widow, which made it a quadrant. So he called the disciples to him and said to them, "Assuredly I say to you that this poor widow has put in more than all those who have given to the treasury. For they all put in out of their abundance, but she out of her poverty put in all that she had, her whole livelihood." May God grant us understanding and love as we read these passages of Scripture. Amen. Listen now as the choir sing for us Abundant Life.
Thank you.
Whenever I read that passage from Mark, before we get to Jesus' reflection about the widow's giving, I shudder a little bit, because it talks about those who wear long robes, which clergy often do, and pray long prayers, which some clergy always do. I think about that when I prepare the prayers for the service. Jesus didn't have much good to say about those people. But he did have good things to say about those who give, those who share. And so my message this morning, those who gave their all. Jesus was a keen observer of all that was going around him. He would have been a good scout, because scouts are taught to be observant. And Jesus was very observant. He noticed as he walked along the roads the flowers in the field and gardens. And he noticed the birds that would fly overhead. He would observe the farmers scattering their seed, and later in the year, gathering their harvest. He would have looked on the faces of those who gathered around him gladly, and he saw them, and he also saw into their hearts, and he saw their deepest need. So it should come as no surprise that as he sat near the temple, he watched the people putting their money into the treasury. And he noticed that those who had much, those who had an abundance, put in much. And he watched as a poor widow put in two mites, two small coins. Everything that Jesus observed, everything he saw, he used to teach others a simple truth. And so he honored the giving of that widow by saying to his disciples, she, out of her poverty, put in all she had, her whole livelihood. It's not at all a very big stretch to connect that story with our connection of what we do here on Remembrance Sunday and what others will do on Thursday. By our act of remembrance, by our wearing of the poppies, by the sound of the trumpet or the skirling of the pipes, by observing the silence, by hearing again the names of those who appear on the honor roll. They are among the many who have given their all in the hope and the desire that we might live in freedom. There's a history in my own family. My father and my father-in-law were veterans of the Second World War. A brother who spent 25 years plus in the Air Force. A daughter who served in the Army Reserve, and, well, I was an Army cadet. And I've had the privilege over the years in all three maritime provinces to work with the members of the Royal Canadian Legion, to serve as a chaplain. Les and I would connect on that point. Many of us, although not being in the military, have stood with members of the armed forces, the police, the RCMP, those of the scouting and guiding movement, the crowds of people, the sound of marching drums, the breezes unfurling the flags, the laying of the wreaths. Sometimes in bright and glorious sunshine, and sometimes in bitter cold. And on those occasions, we are called to remember those huddled in trenches, trying to avoid the bursting of shells overhead and the gunfire. We might suffer for a moment at a remembrance service, but they suffered under very harsh conditions. And all of them were prepared to give their all. And far too many did. It is no small thing by comparison that we take just a bit of our time every November to remember their sacrifice. The story of the poor widow who gave her all. The remembering of those brave people who served in war and in peacekeeping, leaving their families behind. Some of them never to return. That speaks loudly to the world and to us, not only on this remembrance time, in this remembrance time, but all the time. The willingness to give of oneself for the service of others. The needs of the world surround us on every side. We are constantly reminded through the news, the media. And sometimes all of that news that crushes in upon us seems to overwhelm us and almost immobilize us. And then someone issues a call to action, and we are stirred to the very bottom of our hearts. There may be something we can do. There may be something we can do. God wants all people to have adequate food, to have a place of shelter, to receive a good education, to live, work, and play in a safe environment, to be able to go to a doctor or a hospital if they're sick, to be surrounded by those who support them, to be happy with our family and friends. And God wants our help to make it come true. The Mother Teresas and the Desmond Tutus and others of this world have shown us how our own small mites, our own small giving, might be an answer to help a broken world and to make it whole again. They whom we honor and remember gave their all, a shining example to the possibilities, if only our vision is clear enough to see. One thing we all desire is for a better place to live for everyone. So what can you and I give or do in God's work? In one of the visits I was able to make this past week, and in our conversation, we remembered the little phrase, and you may know it too, bloom where you are planted. Let others see what God sees in you. we honor others by following and living their example. We're not asked to give our all, but some do. Amen. Psalm 116, two of the verses there, 12 and 14, say, "What shall I render to the Lord for all his bounty to me? I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people." So let us now dedicate the offering that has already been placed in the plate, or if you forgot, you can do it on your way out. Let us dedicate that prayer, that offering now. God, sometimes your people are required to offer much, even their lives, in the service of justice and freedom. We offer lesser gifts, time, talent, and money, but we too serve justice and freedom. May our offering be pleasing in your sight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now we're going to sing the prayer of St. Francis. Make me a channel of your peace. Now I'm going to lead you in prayer, and I hope after listening to that scripture in Mark, it's not too long. Let us pray. Eternal God, our only hope, our help in times of trouble, show all the nations and all the races and all the groups of people ways to work out differences. Do not let threats multiply or power be used without compassion. May your will overrule human willfulness so that people may agree and settle claims peacefully. Hold back the impulsive, lest desire for vengeance overwhelm our common welfare. Bring peace to earth through Christ, the Prince of Peace. People of Europe torn and tired of being torn, we pray. People of Africa exploited and tired of being exploited, we pray. People of the Middle East turbulent and tired of being turbulent, we pray. People of South America, silenced and tired of being silenced, we pray. People of Asia, divided and tired of being divided, we pray. People of Eastern Europe, anxious and tired of being anxious, we pray. People of the West, privileged and tired of being privileged, we pray. God of all people, grant us grace and peace. We pray in particular for peace for those who are in hospital and those who care for them. Those at home, suffering silently. Those who mourn the loss of a loved one, bowed down with grief. We hold them in our minds and hearts. We pray for family and for friends, for neighbors, comrades, all with whom we meet and encounter in our daily walk. And in that daily walk, may we always recognize that there is one who walks with us, one who taught us a way to pray, and whose words we now use. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now, whether we gather here, or in our own homes, or at cenotaphs as we are able, as we meet people day by day, may the grace of God be with them and with us. And may we share as we are able, in the name of the one who loved us, the one who gave creation life, the one who suffered and died, the one who leads us into all truth, Father, Son, and Spirit. Amen. After the sung benediction, I'm going to pass this over to Reverend Les Johnson.